Thank you.
I'm so thrilled to be here. This has been so exciting, so energizing, so affirming. Being with all of you in this room has been incredibly inspiring. And I am persuaded that we have the people in this space to change the world. And I'm really serious. I believe we can do it. I believe we can actually create some dynamics in the world that force things to change. And I know you've had a lot of wonderful things to put in your head and your heart, and it's been really powerful for me too. I just want to offer a short prescription as you go out and try to change the world, because you're going to get to moments where things feel difficult and challenging and overwhelming. You're going to have a lot of people in your ear telling you to go this way and that way, and I just want to offer you something. I believe if we want to change the world, there are four things we have to do. The first thing we have to do is that we've got to get proximate and stay proximate to the people we care about, the people we serve. We've got to get closer to the poor and the excluded, the disabled and the neglected. If we're trying to change how we deal with the problems of refugees and exiles, we've got to stay close to those who have been exiled and displaced. If we're trying to change how we deal with those who have been addicted and coming out of jails and prisons, we've got to get proximate to those communities. We cannot change the world if we stay at a distance from the problems we're trying to fix. And I say that because I really do believe that when you get proximate to people who are suffering and excluded, people who have been treated unfairly, you learn things that you cannot learn from a distance. When you're proximate, you hear things you can't hear from a distance. You see things you can't see from a distance. I believe there's power in proximity, and you can't wait until you have solutions before you choose to get proximate to those who are suffering. You've got to get proximate just as you are, and the solutions will come in that dynamic. And I've learned about this because my grandmother was the one who taught me about this. My grandmother was one of these amazing people. She was a classic African-American matriarch. She was tough. She was strong. She was loving. She was kind. She was the end of every argument in our family. She was also the start of a lot of arguments in our family. And when I was a little boy, my grandmother would come up to me and she'd give me these hugs and she'd squeeze me so tightly. I thought she was trying to hurt me. And then she'd see me an hour later, and she'd see me, and she'd say, "Brian, do you still feel me hugging you?" And if I said no, she would jump on me again. And by the time I was 10, my grandmother had taught me every time I would see her, I would say, "Mama, I always feel you hugging me." And she would smile this smile, and I didn't appreciate what she was doing until I got much older. And she was a domestic her whole life, and she fell, she broke her hip, she was dying. She was in her 90s, and I went to see my grandmother, and I was sitting there just pouring my heart out because I loved her. She was the daughter of enslaved people. She taught me so much about the world, and I was holding my hand, pouring my heart out, and I stood up to leave, and I didn't even think she was awake, but before I left, my grandmother squeezed my hand. And then she opened her eyes, and she looked at me, and she said, "Brian, do you still feel me hugging you?" And then she said, "I'm always going to be hugging you." And I didn't appreciate the power of that until I started working with death row prisoners and I had to stand next to condemned people who were being wrongly convicted and tortured on death rows. I didn't understand the power of that until I held children, 14, sentenced to die in prison after they'd been abused and assaulted. I didn't appreciate the power of that until I got into difficult places. But what I realized is that we can all hug someone. We can get close enough to the people we serve and embrace them. And you should not doubt the power of what you can do by just holding on to the communities you love, the people you serve. There's power in proximity. I'm the product of someone's choice to get proximate. I'm not here because I'm special or smart or anything. I began my education in a colored school. In my community, black kids couldn't go to the public schools. There were no high schools for black kids when my dad was a teenager. He couldn't go to high school. And lawyers came into our community and they made them open up the public schools. And because those lawyers got proximate to poor black kids like me, I got to go to high school. I got to go to college. I was a philosophy major in college, couldn't figure out what to do. And I looked into graduate school in history and English and political science, and I didn't realize until I looked into it that you actually have to know something about history, English, and political science to get admitted to graduate school. So I kept looking, and to be honest, that's how I found my way to law school. It became very clear to me, you don't need to know anything to go to law school. You don't. So I signed up for that. But I was struggling in law school until I got proximate to condemned people, and it radicalized my interest in the law. And I'm telling you, there's power in proximity. Get close to the people that are suffering and excluded, the people we want to serve, and we'll find our power. But that's not the only thing we have to do. The second thing we've got to do, if we're going to change the world, we've got to change the narratives underneath the issues. We can win the debates, we can win some policy discussions, we can win some of these issues, but if we don't change the narrative, if we don't win the narrative struggle, those policies may not be sustained. There's a narrative underneath these issues. We have mass incarceration in America. because we adopted this misguided war on drugs. We decided to put people who are drug dependent, people who are dealing with addiction, we said they're criminals, and we put them in our jails and prisons. We could have said they're people with medical issues and used our healthcare system to address that, but we didn't do that. And the reason why we didn't do that has to do with a narrative. The people in power were preaching what I call the politics of fear and anger. They wanted people in this country to be afraid and angry, and they used the politics of fear and anger to justify these policies, and I have to tell you that fear and anger are the essential ingredients of injustice. And no matter where you go in the world, you've got to find that narrative of fear and anger, and you've got to fight it. Go any place where there's oppression and abuse, if you ask the oppressors why they do what they do, they'll give you a narrative of fear and anger, and we've got to change that narrative. We've got to change the narrative about race in this country. I can't come to Chicago without talking about the burden that we still face in America. We're not really free in this country. We're not. We're burdened by a history of racial inequality. It's kind of a smog that's in the air, and we all breathe it in. And we've got to change the narrative of racial difference that we have inherited. Our parents should have done it. Our grandparents should have done it. But no one's done it. We've got to do it. You've got to do it. We've got to talk about these things that we haven't talked about. We've got to talk about in this country the fact that we live in a post-genocide society. You see, that there were native people here before European settlers came, and we killed them by the millions through famine and war and disease. It was a genocide, but we didn't call it a genocide. We said, no, these native people, they're different. They're savages, and we use that narrative of racial difference to justify that violence. And that's the narrative that we relied on to sustain 2 centuries of slavery. And I don't think the great evil of American slavery was involuntary servitude or forced labor. I believe the real evil of American slavery was this narrative of racial difference, this ideology of white supremacy that we made up to legitimate the enslavement of black people. So, oh, black people are different than white people. They can't do this, they can't do that. And that narrative of racial difference, that ideology of white supremacy, that was the true evil of American slavery. And if you read the 13th Amendment, it talks about ending involuntary servitude and ending forced labor, but it doesn't say anything about ending this narrative of racial difference. And because of that, I don't think slavery ended in 1865. I think it just evolved. It turned into decades where we had terrorism and black people were pulled out of their homes and burned and mutilated and tortured. And older people of color come up to me sometimes and say, Mr. Stevenson, I get angry when I hear somebody on TV talking about how we're dealing with domestic terrorism for the first time in our nation's history after 9/11. They said, we grew up with terror. We had to worry about being bombed and lynched and menaced every day of our lives. The black people that are here in Chicago, the black people that went to Detroit and Cleveland, Los Angeles and Oakland, did not go to those communities as immigrants looking for new economic opportunities. They came to these communities as refugees and exiles from terror in the American South. And that narrative continued. We had a brilliant civil rights struggle in this country, but we won the passage of the law, the Voting Rights Act, and the Civil Rights Act, but we didn't win the narrative battle. And today, that narrative of racial difference still persists. And black boys and black girls have to overcome these presumptions of dangerousness and guilt. The Bureau of Justice predicts that 1 in 3 black male babies born in this country is expected to go to jail or prison. 1 in 6 Latino boys is expected to go to jail or prison. There is this presumption of dangerousness and guilt, and it doesn't matter whether you're a talented student at Stanford. It doesn't matter whether you're a Harvard professor. It doesn't even matter if you're the president of the United States. You've got to deal with burdens that other people don't have to deal with because your color is black or brown or red, and we've got to change the narrative of racial difference if we truly want to be free. And I think that means talking about these things. If you go to South Africa, you can't spend time there without seeing the legacy of apartheid. In Rwanda, they make you hear about the genocide. In Germany, you can't go 100 meters in Berlin without seeing markers and stones that have been placed next to the homes of Jewish families. The Germans want you to go to the Holocaust Memorial, but in this country, we don't talk about slavery. We don't talk about lynching. We don't talk about segregation. We don't talk about race. We don't talk about racial justice, and we've got to change that narrative. My project in Montgomery, we're putting markers at every lynching site in America. We're going to open a museum next April that you're all invited to. We've created this memorial to peace and justice, and I want you to all come because we're trying to change this narrative. We've got to do something about the narrative. Third, you can't change the world by just changing narratives and staying proximate. The third thing you've got to do is you've got to stay hopeful. And this has been such an encouraging and inspiring summit. I just want to enforce this idea that your hope is your superpower. Don't let anybody or anything make you hopeless. Hopelessness is the enemy of justice. Injustice prevails where hopelessness persists. And your hope is your superpower. Hope is what will get you to stand up when other people say sit down. Hope is what will get you to speak when other people say be quiet. Your hope is your superpower. Hold on to it. Fight anybody that tries to take it away from you. It will help you change the world. And fourth and finally, if we're going to change the world, we got to stay hopeful. We got to get proximate. We got to change narratives. But the fourth thing we've got to be willing to do is we've got to be willing to do uncomfortable things. We cannot change the world if we're unwilling to do things that are inconvenient or uncomfortable. The president talked about it yesterday. We can't just be in the spaces where people affirm what we think and say we've got to go into spaces where people are pushing back. But our capacity to do the uncomfortable opens up the door to changing the world. I learned something about doing the uncomfortable. I'll end with this. I was giving a talk in a church, and this older black man came into the church. He was in a wheelchair. And he was sitting in the back, and he was staring at me with this stern, angry look on his face. I couldn't figure out, why is he looking at me like that? And he was just looking so intensely. He was kind of distracting me during my talk because he had this stern, angry look. And I got through the talk, and people came up. They were very nice and appropriate. But that older man kept sitting in the back. And when everybody else walked away, he wheeled himself to the front of the church. And when he got in front of me, he put his hand up. He said, "Do you know what you're doing?" And I just stood there. And then he asked me again, he said, "Do you know what you're doing?" And I stepped back and I mumbled something. And then he asked me one last time, he said, "Do you know what you're doing?" And then he looked at me, he said, "I'm going to tell you what you're doing." And that older black man looked at me and he said, "You're beating the drum for justice. You keep beating the drum for justice." And I was so moved. I was also really relieved because I just didn't know what was about to happen. And then this man grabbed me by my jacket. He pulled me into his wheelchair. He said, "Come here, come here, come here. I'm going to show you something." And he turned his head. He said, "You see the scar I have behind my right ear?" He said, "I got that scar in Greene County, Alabama, 1963, trying to register people to vote." He turned his head. He said, "You see this cut I have down here at the bottom of my neck? Got that cut in Philadelphia, Mississippi, 1964, trying to register people to vote." He turned his head. He said, "You see this dark spot?" He said, "That's my bruise. Got my bruise in Birmingham, Alabama, 1965, trying to register people to vote." He looked at me. He said, "I'm going to tell you something, young man." He said, "People look at me, they think I'm some old man sitting in a wheelchair covered with cuts and bruises and scars." He said, "But I'm going to tell you something." He said, "These are not my cuts. They're not my bruises." He said, "These are not my scars." He said, "These are my medals of honor." And I think to honor what we've learned, to honor the energy of this space, to honor the legacy created by this summer, to honor the calling that we have all answered to change the world, we're going to have to be willing to do uncomfortable things. We're going to have to be willing to be that community of people that sometimes gets a little nicked and scarred, but we should know that we're not doing it alone. We are together in this. And if we get proximate, if we change narratives, if we stay hopeful, if we do uncomfortable things, I am persuaded that we really can change the world. And I just want to wish you the very best in that pursuit and to let you know that when you stand, I'm going to stand with you. I hope when I stand, you'll stand with me. When we each stand, we should wrap each other's arms around ourselves and let the world know that we are here for change. I wish you all the best. Thank you very much.